volunteers to listen to my conversation. This is wonderful. So I'm Jesus. I was born in Mexico, and I moved here when I was 10 years old. I've been in Waukegan for now 28 years. And I've graduated out of Waukegan High School. I attended Loyola University. Most of you have seen the articles that have been around. I was in the Chronicle for a month there. They did a great article, but my face was all over the place. And I'm like, I'm running into here. I see my face. I'm running into there. There it is again, which is great. One of the reasons that I put a presentation like this together was because it takes a lot of time for students to actually understand the Latino reality, specifically for Latino students. A lot of us go through an educational system that was not necessarily designed to serve us, that was not designed to serve the community of Latino descent. And so a lot of times we question whether we have the capacity to actually move forward academically in a system that, again, wasn't designed for us. We walk into school buildings where most of our teachers don't understand our language, don't understand our culture, and have a very hard time understanding some of our challenges. And so as we move through the system, we continue to question our ability to be successful. And that happens not just as we begin even in kindergarten, but it happens throughout college. For a lot of us, the realization of who we are, where we come from, the idea that we are descendants of proud people, brilliant people in Latin America, doesn't come in easily. We go through college without even thinking about it. We begin to understand it once we reach the graduate level, at the master's level. And that is if we are lucky enough to take classes that actually talk about some of these issues. For many years, I looked at my community with an idea of, or a deficit lens, what is called a deficit lens. A lens of saying, you know, my community doesn't want to go to college. My community focuses on working. My community focuses on many things that is not going to get us anywhere. That was the lens I looked at my community as I was growing up. And I can honestly tell you that there were moments where I was ashamed of my own community and my background. How do we as Latinos get to that point where we say, you know, I'm ashamed that, you know, my mom dropped out of the third grade, that my dad didn't finish grade school. When I see my friends in other communities whose fathers are doctors, whose fathers have master's degrees, and mine could not reach that level. That creates a feeling of shame, but also kind of kills our souls inside as Latinos. When we are thinking about how little credit our people is given in this country to the fact of, you know, we created the greatest nation on earth, the American exceptionalism, we are taken out of the equation many times. And the aportations of our people are not considered. It was not until my graduate school experience with my master's program that I began to critically think about the place of Latinos in America, that I began to understand that this country could not exist without us, that we are an integral piece of its success. And it was then that I started to say, well, you know, my parents, without a high school diploma, have been able to give me everything that I have been able to show me skills that I'll use throughout my life, and has shown me traditions and ways of survival that I'll be able to pass on to my kids one day. And it's those little things that we continue to grow as Latinos without even noticing, without even thinking about it. And part of it has to do with the fact that the educational system hasn't adapted to the changes in population and in demographics. We'll talk about some of those things also, but one of the things that I want you to just know is that what I'm going to be talking about is coming from me as a Mexican-American male. There's many things in here that may not apply to those of us who come from Central America, those of us that come from South America, those of us who were born in this country, and those of us who are not Latino. Some of the things that I'll mention will be controversial. Again, it's coming from my personal experience. It's coming from my own learning. So don't take anything that I say personally. We are talking about a system. We are talking about our society as a whole. And it's something that needs to be addressed. You know, those hard and tough conversations that we sometimes avoid in higher education need to happen. So as I move forward, again, keep an open mind. I am happy to answer questions. I am happy to listen as well. If there is a question that you have as I go through this, just answer, raise your hand. I'll be happy to call on you. But if the questions can wait until the end, that's even better. But I know that, you know, some of the things that I'll be touching upon are just going to be burning inside, and you want to ask, and I'm happy to touch upon that. So first of all, we'll start with a little vocabulary, because some of that vocab, or actually, no, let's go back. Can somebody tell me where this is? What image this is? Out of where did it come? Where did it come from?
Guanajuato.
Guanajuato. What part of Guanajuato? San Miguel Allende. Yes, yes. So this is the first time that I present this and somebody actually knows where this is at. Most of the time, they say, oh, is this Spain? You know, is this Madrid or La Sagrada Familia? What is this? Well, this is San Miguel Allende, Guanajuato, one of the most beautiful places in Mexico. I visited this place as a child, and I always saw this statue here, Friar San Miguel, consoling Native American from that area, probably some of our ancestors there. But whenever you walk in here, this is one of the first things you see outside the church. For me, this, as I was growing up, didn't symbolize anything. It just symbolized somebody being compassionate and consoling somebody. As I understood more about the colonization of the Americas, as I understood more about white supremacy, about Eurocentrism, this turned into something else. This turned into an image that revered the friar, the Catholic Church, and saw the native people of Mexico as somebody that needed to be saved, as people that needed salvation, that needed help, that could not survive on their own, that needed to see the light. That was a tough realization, because this is not the only statue that you see like this in Mexico. It's all over the place. But that change in mindset and being able to question some of the things that are out there and that we see out there without even thinking, again, took many, many years, many decades of study, many decades of actually living that example with my teachers, with my professors, with people in the community, actually saying, well, you need to do this to be successful, and here I'm going to help you with that. One of the first examples of that was as a young high school student in Waukegan, and I visited my counselor. I was a very good student, 3.89 GPA. And he said, you know, Jesus, you probably will get into many colleges, but for you to actually be able to do well and for people to look at you seriously, you need to work on your accent. You should take a course or something just to get rid of your accent. And again, that was the idea. Maybe, you know, it was coming from the best of intentions. But for me to actually go through that, that was a suggestion that I should assimilate into mainstream society, into white Eurocentric society. Living behind, you know, all the hard work of actually learning the language, because my accent tells people as soon as I open my mouth that I'm not originally from here. And some of my friends used to tease me and say, you know, Jesus, just don't open your mouth and they'll think you're white. don't talk. And they'll think you're white. But anyway, play birds. So a couple of the words that I wanted to present to you. Culture. Can somebody give me a description of culture? I'm sorry? Come on, tell me. No wrong answer.
Basically, the system of, it includes the system of beliefs, culture, religion, history, all that in one.
Yeah.
Tradition.
All right, good. Colonialism. Who can tell me what colonialism is? Come on, we're a college. Yes, we know what colonialism is. What's a colony? Yes?
When one country conquers another and essentially establishes that conquered country as like an outpost of their own country.
Absolutely.
And changes it according to their cultural beliefs and otherwise.
Yes, yes. Racism, I'm sorry, Eurocentrism.
Yes, sir.
Seeing everything through a European lens and, yeah, having that lens and superiority.
Racism, we know what that is. We don't need a discussion about that. Social Darwinism, that's a good one. Somebody, nobody? Remember Darwin? Evolution?
Survival
of the fittest, absolutely. And that was applied to society. Saying, you know what? If you can't survive, if you can't be successful, then you deserve to not be successful. If you don't have what it takes to survive, then you're not worthy. That is an idea that is still around, unfortunately. White privilege. I just gave you a perfect example a little ago. You know, the fact that I'm way lighter than my Latino, than many of my Latino counterparts, gives me privilege. It gives me something that allows me to integrate, if I really wanted to, into white mainstream society. But a lot of people actually question white privilege as something that is wrong. And, you know, it is wrong in a society. But those individuals that take advantage of that doesn't really mean that, you know, their life has been easy. And that's the statement that I have back here. It just means that your skin color isn't one of the things making your life harder. So I thought that was a great description of it. You know, in Latin America, and specifically in Mexico, where I grew up, if you were white skin, green eyes, you got privileged. People treated you differently because it was usually you who had money. It was usually your parents who were educated. It was usually your parents that had the means, and so you were treated differently. As a kid, I attended grade school in Mexico, and for every national celebration, Independence Day, Día de la Revolución, Revolution Day, which is actually today, a little over 20, I would dress up as a charro. And that went on for 5 years, you know, in this very traditional Mexican suit, and I would represent my school in the marching band parade. And people would ask all the time, why do you pick the same kid every year? Why is it that the same kid is picked every year? Like, well, because he's the güerito with green eyes. You know, and it was a complete opposite of what that actually dress should represent in Mexico. It was me, and it was me chosen for a particular reason. Not that I earned it, it was a privilege to do that, because I was lighter and green eyes. White supremacy, that's different than a couple other things. But white supremacy is, just, again, somebody can give me a definition of that or your own interpretation of it? You want to speak up? No? You're going to make me a little bit hard.
Like racist?
I'm sorry?
When I think of white supremacy, I think of like the same word of racism.
It's a little different. Though. It's a little different. It's the idea that the white race, and again, race quotations, there's only one race, the human race. But as we define it in society, the idea that the white race is above or somehow superior to any other.
More deserving,
exactly. Assimilation.
I'll take assimilation and integration. So, like, I think of food a lot, right? So for assimilation, it would be like a cream soup. So you have all these ingredients and you chop them up and cook them up and you blend it so that you can't tell when it's done what's what. It's just one thing. Right? So that's like check your culture at the door. We're all one. We're all Americans. We don't have an individual identity as a nationality. But integration is, hey, we're Mexican, we're Chinese, we're whatever, and we're all part, and that's a salad. So a salad, you still know what each part is.
You got it.
And it tastes really good, and you make it healthy, and it's healthier than a cream soup.
It's still wonderful that you can still see the different messages. And, you know, as we have seen over the last couple of years, there's been a lot of discussions about things like this. What is it that actually makes America great? What is it that actually makes our country exceptional and our society something that millions want to join? You know, people die at the border trying to reach us. People wait decades to be able to join us. What is it that makes us so unique and makes people want to come to this country? Well, it's the fact that we are diverse and we are not necessarily assimilating people, we're integrating them. They are able to keep their identity. They are able to make this country unique because we take the best talent out of the entire world and we use it to make this country what it is today. We attract talent because we are a country that is accepting, and we are a country that brings people in for a better life. Think about that in a little bit, and then you'll see why I made that comment. Cultural appropriation. Yes?
Taking in somebody else's culture and, well, picking certain aspects of somebody's culture and using it to make a profit.
Yes, that's a good description. Absolutely. Cinco de Mayo, it's a great example. As I was growing up, and again, some of these things have been out there for a while, but as I was growing up, I saw Cinco de Mayo as nothing major. You know, it's not in Mexico that we celebrate Cinco de Mayo, that wasn't celebrated here. But when you start seeing that kind of celebration with the hats and the mustaches and the alcohol and the consumption, that is cultural appropriation. You are taking somebody else's culture, trying to make a profit, mocking it, and even presenting an argument without actually knowing the facts. Systemic racism. No.
You could look at the school system, for example.
Yes.
And for example, that when you compare whites versus blacks and how they are disciplined in the school system, it's a lot different. There's much more of a bias, and it creates a whole set of problems as a result of it. And that you could call that systemic, for example, within K-12.
So it's racism that makes a system ineffective and unfair. Right? So we're talking about school system, higher education system, legal system, systems that are meant to protect us or to help us all equally are impacted by racism. Systemic racism is something that we've tackled in this country for many years, and we're still fighting to eliminate. Meritocracy. What's meritocracy? The idea that if you work really hard, you'll get what you want, that you'll be successful, that whatever you get, it's because of merit, because you deserve it. As I was growing up, I truly believe in meritocracy because that's the idea that my parents sold me when I was growing up. And they said, we moved to this country, even reluctantly, out of Mexico, because we want to give you a better life. And mijo, you should know that if you work really hard, you're going to get what you want, that this country provides opportunities that no other country does. And then I began to think, and I said, geez, if you work really hard, you should get what you want. Heck, but I don't know anybody that works harder than mom and dad. Mm-hmm. And they still not reaching that pinnacle. So is meritocracy really something that is reachable, that is true, that is fair, that is actually working in our country? I don't know. But that belief had me fooled for many years. And then why nationalism? Different than all the other stuff that we already talked. Any ideas why? The idea that we need to create a country that is specifically serving the white population. The idea that there is no place for anybody else in that space. But some of the things that I put up here, for example, one study found that 67% of doctors have biases against African American patients. That is a fact. 67% of doctors have biases. What does that mean? That means that if I'm African-American and I walk into a doctor's office, they are more likely not to believe that I'm sick. They are more likely to believe that I'm making it up or that I'm exaggerating the pain that I'm in. When we look at the water crisis in Flint, people were able to make some of those decisions because, quite honestly, it was a different kind of population. They're still suffering the crisis because of the kind of population that is affecting. When we look at, you mentioned the jail population, 13% of the general population is the African American community, but 40% of the prison population. That is a perfect example of a system that is clearly not working. I use some of the examples from the African American community because over the decades, the Latino community and the African-American community have been pegged against each other many, many times. And it's done on purpose, either to separate our votes or to make sure that we are always fighting for the morsels of our society. and it has not served either community well. And so being able to recognize that the challenges that one community is facing are the same challenges that the other community is facing is incredibly important, because then you can become a team, you can become a force that fights against some of those issues. So Latinos, who we are? Who are we? There's no description for a Latino, quite honestly. We are incredibly diverse within our own group. We have different agendas. We speak different dialects in Spanish. Some of us have issues in understanding one another. We have political ideologies that go from one side to the other. But Vasconcelos, a Mexican philosopher, once described us as la raza cósmica, or the cosmic race. We're a mixture of races. We are Native American, Black, White, European, Middle Eastern. We are a mixture throughout Latin America. But there's also something that we have to understand, and that is that we are a conquered people. That European, the Spanish and European conquest changed us drastically and changed the future of our country drastically and our people drastically. There was an effect that came after the conquest. For example, Native history is not recognized as important. Now, I'm not talking about the U.S. I'm talking about our Latin American countries, and I'm talking about the big picture. When you look at the civilizations that we had in Latin America, they were wonderful, incredible civilizations. There were issues like any other civilization, but they were able to survive for hundreds and hundreds of years. They created great societies. The European conquest changed all of that. Ways of knowing were discredited by an imposed culture, which means that even though we had these wonderful civilizations, and we had universities in the Aztec Empire, they were dismantled. We had books that talked about culture back then, they were burned. One of the ways that a conquest works and a colonization works is you try to destroy not only the present state of the people you're trying to conquer, but you try to destroy their past. If you break the connection to the past, you erase history. And there is no point in going back and understanding who you are. You are now becoming what you presently are. You erase the idea of being a proud people, and you break people down. And that's exactly what happened during the colonization of Latin America. Christianity and Catholicism were replaced as the native faith. That is, again, demonstrated by the fact that Catholic churches were built upon the top of pyramids, the top of temples in the Aztec Empire. The propagation of Eurocentric values, that is a major theme of this presentation also, and some of the things that actually affect us the most as Latinos. When you look at telenovelas, and you look at who the heroine of telenovelas is, what do you see? Who is the heroine of telenovelas? Usually. Describe her.
Light skin.
Light skin.
Blonde.
And so when you look at that, is that the description of 90% of Mexicans? It is not. But yet, you use that in telenovelas for a reason. There's a reason they use that. And they don't use the darker Latina as a heroine of those telenovelas. And the reason is that as Latinos, we have a Eurocentric lens. We believe that beauty, that whatever has value, has to be European. Right? Chocolate. When we look at chocolate, Belgian chocolate, wonderful, great, Swiss chocolate. Not knowing the chocolate originator in Mexico, we have some of the best chocolate in the world. Are you kidding me? But you look at things through this Eurocentric lens. The propagation of Eurocentric values, exploitation and loss of wealth are part of our history. We have lost wealth like probably few other areas in the world, maybe Africa. But yeah, they ransacked Latin America. Ships full of gold and silver, and yes.
So I love your accent. Could you be louder? Maybe
I can use the mic.
Okay, that'd be awesome.
I'll step behind you.
Yeah.
All right. So hope that's better. Sorry. So anyway, the Loss of wealth of Latin America is historic. We saw ships full of gold and silver leave Peru, leave Mexico. Currently, you know, the exploitation of our lands are still ongoing. And that's not just Latin America, it happens in the US. When we look at our native population trying to protect their land from the Keystone Project, for example, the exploitation is rampant and still ongoing. Latinos are both immigrant and native to this country. There's a saying in Spanish that says, I did not cross the border crossed me. Yo no crucé la frontera me cruzó a mí. Completely true, and I'll talk a little bit about that also. But as I mentioned, we need to recognize that we are very diverse, and that not all Latinos are immigrants. we have to understand who we are in order to understand our reality. Time Magazine had this image back in 2006, I believe, about the new face of America, and this was basically what the average face of an American would look like in the year 2050. That's usually not what we think about when we think about the average American. This was the projection. There's a demographic change happening in this country, and we need to understand it. So colonialism and its legacy. So what did we get with the colonialist piece? So we got the language, of course, Spanish. We got the idea that Spanish is the language to learn, even in Mexico. If you don't speak Spanish, and there's over 200 languages in Mexico that are spoken by the natives, you are discriminated against. People see you as lesser. Skin tone, the idea that whiteness is better, is also something that was left in there. Religion, the idea of property is an interesting one. So back in the before the colonial era, in Mexico there was no idea of, or there was no notion of private property. Property was held by villages. Property was held by those who worked the land, and they shared on the profits. But with the European invasion, well, the idea of private property came on board. And so that changed the way that our society in Mexico was formed. Scholarship was also changed. Why do I mention scholarship? Scholarship is an interesting piece and a very important one. Because when you look at all the books and all the documents that have been published over the centuries about Mexico and its culture, about Latin America and its culture, it hasn't been Mexicans who have written those books. It hasn't been Mexicans who have done the research about their own culture. It's usually driven out of American universities by American writers. When you go to the library and look at books that talk about Latino culture, look at the names on those books, look at the authors, and look at the backgrounds. And that is an issue, and it's an issue for me because there's reasons behind that. First of all, not many of us as Latinos actually make it to be able to publish a book out of an institution like Harvard or Yale or even UIC. We don't make it to those levels, and we don't have the critical mass to do the research. But many times when you are writing a book, well, all the time basically, you are writing a book based on a particular lens. You have your experiences, and that's how you write, and that's how you see the world. And so having those resources written by people that have actually gone through that experience is important. Knowledge, the idea of knowledge, again, when you're in Mexico, and I'll give you an example. You have two people arguing, and you see one that is dressed just like me today, and you have another one who is dressed in a traditional clothing, in native Mexican clothing. Who do you think people will believe? The person dressed like me, absolutely. And it's the idea that truth is very specific to a very specific kind of people. And I will believe that kind of people, not necessarily you, because you don't fit my scheme of who would be truthful and honest. There's also something I call the mande usted complex in our society. And so this is something that makes Latinos seem to be submissive, that we have a submissive demeanor. And we see poverty as a norm for our people, inequality as a norm as well. But the Mandel State Complex, and many of you who are Latinos would know what I'm talking about once I give you the example. You know, you go walking through the street, somebody calls your name, and you turn around and you say Mande. Remember that? How many of you have used that? Yeah, a lot of us, a lot of us. Understanding where that comes from is important because Mande is basically you're turning around and telling somebody who's calling your name, order me, tell me what to do, I'm here to serve you. And so that is a complex that we have as Latinos. And you know, as a kid, I had no idea what I was saying when I was going down the street and saying Mande usted or Mande. And when, once I learned this, I'm like, I'm never using that again. So, you know, that's crazy. I'll say, dígame, but not Mande, you can't order me around, come on. So anyway, that was something that, again, if you were a Native American or Native Mexican, you were expected that, you know, if I as a European were call your name, it's not because I want to say hello, it's because I need to order you, because I need something from you. So you were ready to serve me. History is one-sided. Most of the time it's one-sided. I remember when I was in grade school in Mexico, I learned about the Mexican-American War, and I'll talk a little bit about it now. But in Mexico, it's the American invasion. That's how we refer to it. And it's a very different story than the story that we learn here in our textbooks. It's incredibly different. I'll talk a bit about it in a bit. But the idea, again, of white privilege, and the idea that if you are lighter skinned, you have more credibility, that you are more likely to be telling me the truth than if you're not. This is a document that I found at the University of Washington that talks about, and I don't know that you can see it or read it, but it talks about London, Madrid, and Tenochtitlan, the capital of the Aztec Empire, back in 1519, and the state of their forest, the soil, the wetlands, and the biodiversity, among other things. But basically, what we see here is that in regards to population, London had 90,000 people back then, Madrid had 100,000, Tenochtitlan had 300 to 500,000 people, so five times as large as Madrid and London. However, when you go to the textbooks, do you really look at the great civilizations, you usually don't learn about these things. You usually don't see that kind of comparison. When you look at the state of the forests in London and Madrid, there were excessive deforestation. They were getting rid of their forests. In Mexico, even though they were handling 500,000 people, the forests were intact. Our people took care of their environment. When you look at the state of the wetlands, there was loss in London and Madrid. In Tenochtitlan, they took care of them. Huge net gain. Chinampas was one of the great agricultural practices in Tenochtitlan, where they used the lake and the soil and all of that to create gardens, and they took care of their wetlands. One of my favorite ones was the sanitary conditions, the comparison between those. The sanitary conditions in London and Madrid. So, you know, you need to go to the bathroom in the middle of the night in 1519. What do? You get your chamber pot out of the bottom of your bed, and you use it, and then you put it back under the bed, and then in the following morning, what do? How do you get rid of it? Throw it out the street. Hopefully nobody gets hit with it, but that was the practice. The streets were, you know, raw sewage running out of the street. Tenochtitlan didn't have that. They actually recycled human waste into the chinampas. They used it as fertilizer. The streets were clean. When you read about these things and you start understanding that the civilization that we left behind or that was completely destroyed or most of it was destroyed was as brilliant as that. And that yet, Latino children don't learn about these things when they're in grade school, when they're in middle school, that a document like this, only what 3% of Latinos have seen? It's appalling, because then you start, again, creating the idea that we as a people are not worthy, that we as a people have nothing to offer civilization. And so you begin to feel inadequate. But my point in showing you this is the fact that our students need to feel worthy. They need to feel proud of where they're coming from. And many times our system of education does not do that for them. On the contrary, we are pictured as invaders in our own land. So it is important to understand that as we're growing up as Latinos, there is a change in our psyche, that the way our education system responds to us molds us. And so finding those allies out there that are able to illustrate something like this to a child in middle school is incredibly empowering to them. So it's important to understand some of those things. I'll move on. So Latinos as Americans. Again, we're not all immigrants. In 1845, we had the what we called in Mexico the American Invasion. We call it here the Mexican-American War. But it was the first war to be fought out of greed, manifest destiny. The idea that we needed to expand our country from one side of one ocean to the other, and the idea that we wasn't able to take it. You know, they many times offered Mexico to sell that territory. Mexico said no, so you know, we'll figure out a way of getting it. And they did. But in the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo, which actually ended the war, there was a couple clauses in there. One of the clauses said that property ownership of those Mexican families that remained in those territories would be respected. That if they owned land, their land would stay with them. There was also a clause that said that they would be given the right to vote in those territories. Do you think that was respected? No, it wasn't. It was one of the largest transfers of wealth this country has seen, because all of the families, or a lot of the families that owned land back in the in what used to be Mexico, lost it. And they lost it in many different ways. But when the US came about, first of all, and one of the big changes was that Mexico did not charge you taxes for owning property back in those days. They charge you for the products that you got of the land. So if you have cattle, they would tax the cattle or the heads of cattle that you had. They would tax the corn that you would, you know, get out of that land. But you did not pay taxes just for the mere fact of owning the land. If you didn't have anything being produced in that land, you did not pay anything. Well, when the US came about, property taxes came. You needed to pay for the mere fact of owning that piece of land. Well, Mexicans in that land didn't speak the language, much less understand the legal system. They went on a couple of years without paying the property taxes, and guess what happened? They got foreclosed. Absolutely, their land was taken. Nobody was able to tell them, hey, there's a new system coming in, you need to pay taxes on your land. And by the time that this happened, of course, they tried to fight it off, many of them, and there's I have good resources if anybody's interested on that piece of story, but they actually had to sell their land to pay the legal fees to defend it. So you've heard about squatters as well. You know, they would go into Mexican land and just say, you know, I kind of like this piece, I'm going to fence it off, and as those Mexican families try to claim it, they went to court, spent a lot of money, and then they brought their paperwork from the Spanish Crown or the Mexican government saying that this is your land. Well, the way they described the property titles back then, if you look at a map of Chicago, you see that it's very nicely gridded. It has nice boundaries and all of that. Well, the documentation back then was basically they would tell you, Jesus owns a land from the edge of the river to the top of that mountain to the elm tree that is 2 leagues that way. That's the way they described land. When the Mexican families got to the court system, the American court system, and gave them that kind of paperwork, what do you think they said? You make this crap up. You know, this means nothing. There's no way of knowing that somebody already, you know, tore down that tree or the river moved or whatever. So there was ways of getting that land out of the Mexican hands. And of course, there was intimidation and violence. This is the entry of the American army into Mexico City. This is a very famous painting in Mexico. And of course, we all know, I've seen this map before, probably. I think a vodka company used it. People were not very happy back in a couple of years ago. But we know that there's also a wound that doesn't heal in our community as Americans, as Latino Americans. And that wound has a profound effect on how we act, how we respond, and how safe and welcome we feel in this country and even our own communities. And that's the immigration issue. When you think about immigration, you cannot unlink it from labor. And the way that I've seen the American way of looking at immigrants, and specifically those that are looking for jobs, is yes, we have the jobs that no other American wants to do, but what we need is a disposable workforce. We need people that will come in, do the job, and then get out. And that happens very often now in our communities. When I was attending Loyola, I took the train. You know, I didn't have the money to stay on campus, so I commuted every single day from Waukegan, and I took the train. And as soon as the train hit Kenilworth, Winnetka, those very wealthy cities, I would see a lot of Latinos jumping on the train, heading back home. Some of them would get off the train in Highwood, but most of them will come to North Chicago and Waukegan, even Zion. And you begin to think, well, so these communities, these very wealthy communities, absolutely need the workforce. We want you to come in and clean my house and take care of my kids, but I don't want you to live around the corner from me. I don't need you in that community. Come in, do the work, and leave. And that's the same way that happened in regards to labor force in America. We needed, we wanted a disposable workforce. That we had mass deportations in the 1930s because you know, people were taking America's jobs in the fields in California. Well, the war comes around, World War II, and then we need workers because all our able men are leaving off to war, so who's gonna do the work? We begin the Bracero program, which brought 4.2 million workers to America, mainly from Mexico, who paid taxes, paid Social Security, paid Medicare, and got nothing out of it. My grandfather was one of those braceros in the 1940s, in 1960s actually. He was actually in 62. And he paid taxes, quite a few of them, and never got a single dime off of that. It was a disposable workforce. We want you in, and then when you're done, get out. The immigration battle has instilled fear, necessity, and hardship among our people. I think every single Latino in this room probably knows an undocumented person. The fear of la migra, the word that you never speak of, the word that creates fear in the ears of our people, but more recently, in the hearts of our children. Today we have another piece or another delivery of what the Bracero program used to do. It's now Los Contratados. Those people that come from the indigenous communities in southern Mexico who actually pay a fee to recruiters for a visa to come and board during the summer here. They are rigged with low wages, no benefits, long hours, and once they're done, they go back home. And they begin the process all over again the following year. We're talking about exploitation here. Economic exploitation goes beyond just the immigration system. When we look at our Latino communities, we see tons of payday loan stores. We see charter schools popping up all over the place, and a housing market that is incredibly unfair. Back in 2005, 2006, if you were undocumented and you wanted to buy a house, banks were ready to give you money at the turn of a dime, just like that. You didn't need a social, you could get money with an ITIN, and they give you $250,000 if you needed one to buy a house in Waukegan. Those people got loans. When the economy crashed, they lost their homes. They could not keep up with the payments. And that $250,000 home is now worth $40,000. People had no choice. But as an undocumented immigrant, you can't borrow money when those houses were $40,000 now, or $60,000. Because, oh no, we made a mistake, you know, we can't loan you money now, you need a social. If you don't have a social security number, we won't give you money. We gave you money before when the houses were worth $250,000, but now that you could actually afford them at $60,000, there's no credit for you. I could tell you that there are entire blocks in Waukegan that are owned by people who live in Lake Forest who rent them out and took advantage of the crash. Again, the exploitation and the transfer of wealth from one community to the other. DACA is another piece. DACA is, you know, it's incredible how our society has used DACA and our government has used DACA in the last couple of years. it's a way of trying to control our community and saying, you know, we're going to build a wall where your DACA students will not get a renewal next year. Or, you know, we're going to let DACA expire and then we can work on a comprehensive immigration reform. It's a bargaining chip. And it's so unfortunate because we are playing with the lives of our students, we are playing with the lives of children. And people don't understand why the immigration piece is so unfair. I have an aunt in Mexico who's been waiting for 25 years to come to this country legally. 25 years is half a lifetime. How can we expect people to wait that long to reunite with their families? It's unfair. The other piece is the segregation of our communities. When you look at Chicago and Illinois and all of those other areas with high concentrations of Latinos, our community is segregated. We have our own little corner of the city, our own little corner of the county, and that creates problems because that means that the vast majority of our children go to a specific school district. And the funding of that specific school district is linked to property taxes. So if, you know, 90% of Latinos live in Waukegan, then 90% of our children are attending underfunded schools in Waukegan. This is the disposable workforce. This is who feeds our families. This is who gets the food to our tables. We're earning a couple dollars an hour out in the fields of California. Not only are they working long hours and getting paid incredibly low wages, but they're also being bombarded with pesticides and fertilizers and all of that. Their life expectancy is way lower than the average American. And this is just an exhibit that they had at the Mexico Museum of Art last year, where, yeah, wonderful raisins sent to us by death. This is the story of one of those workers out in the fields, and I'm not going to wait till we read the whole thing, but this is basically a girl, a 16-year-old girl who works in the fields. She's a young mother. And when she was asked, so what does the future hold for you? She just says, there's no future. You know, I work in the field. There's no way I can go to school. I got to take care of my child. I have no options. I have to keep working. And with my child in hand, I can't do much. She is originally from Oaxaca. And there is, in my head, a question as to whether if this was a girl who was not Latina, she would be in the same situation, or whether we would have state agencies trying to reach her and help her. And because she's a migratory worker, she is forgotten. We have educational issues in our community, the idea of deficit thinking. Can somebody tell me what deficit thinking is? No? Well, deficit thinking is the idea that family bears the responsibility for a child's success, and that because a family doesn't have the ability to teach them or show them the way to success, the child is meant to fail. The responsibility of success is placed on the parents, and the blame for not being successful is placed on the parents or the family. Deficit thinking is the idea that because you are a poor Latino, you have less ability and a higher chance of failure than the average child in our schools. We have language issues, absolutely. There's a vast number in our community who have the inability to communicate in English. That's an issue. However, when I was a child, I was part of the bilingual program in Waukegan, and I was very successful in you know, navigating the system through that because I was taught in Spanish the critical subjects that I needed to learn. Math and science and history were taught in Spanish. I cannot imagine how I would have performed in tests and in lectures or, you know, in the classroom if all I heard was English instruction without knowing the language. Those programs are being eliminated. The Spanish language programs are being eliminated in public schools, And so the idea is to get children into a transitional space where they'll hear a little bit of Spanish, but most of the instruction is given in English, and move them as quickly into the regular classes as possible. And while those programs are being eliminated for Latinos, the bilingual programs are being eliminated, guess what's happening in mainstream schools?
Dual language
programs. There's a statistic out there that says that by the year 2060, the biggest number of Spanish speakers will not be Latinos in this country. Imagine that. So Spanish is okay for other populations, but not for Latino kids. They need to just speak one language, English only. So there's standardized tests. Again, who are those tests designed for? They're not designed for a Latino kid. I was in downtown Chicago, a little village, and one of my cohort, I'm a part of a cohort, PhD cohort, and one of my friends there says, you know, I was walking down the street the other day, and here's this kid who is in sixth grade and has trouble in math. Every single test he takes, it's a D or a C minus. I mean, he has trouble in math all the time. And yet, he's helping his mother sell fruit in Little Village out of a fruit cart. And so I played a little game with him. I went there and I bought a couple things, and my bill was about $8.50. I gave the kid $6.75. And I just said, okay, thank you. He gave him the money. And within 30 seconds, the kid goes, hey, you owe me money. Where are you going? So this kid is able to do math in his head when it applies to his life experience. He's able to do the math when it's part of his experience, but not able to perform on tests that have nothing to do with them. If you ask him a word problem where he's trying to figure out, I don't know, the square footage of a garage, the kid lives in an apartment, hasn't even seen a garage. You know, so how are those questions being applied to the actual experience of our children? It's part of the problem. Parental engagement. The parental engagement piece is critical. I spent quite a bit of time researching that piece during my doctorate studies. And just the way that we expect our parents to get engaged in school is very different than the way that our parents are used to being engaged in school. For my mom and for my dad, their responsibility with me and my education was to feed me, make sure that I had no lice on my head, that I was well fed in the morning, that my shoes were clean, that my nails were clipped. They took care of that. That I was being respectful to my teachers, that I did my homework, but they never took the time to actually help me with my homework. That was not their responsibility, that was the responsibility of the teachers in Mexico. For two reasons. First of all, because the teachers held a position of respect in Mexico. They are the ones that know how to do this. And if I can't teach you, I have a third grade education, how am I supposed to teach you? But the teacher will take care of it. It's a very different parental interaction piece, and we don't understand that. We try to make Latino parents get engaged the same way that we have our non-Latino parents become engaged in the schools. And it actually creates a problem. First of all, you know, parents work two jobs and able to sustain their families. How can they volunteer in the PTO and attend the meetings and do the bake sales and all of that? That's a luxury that our community does not have. But yet, parental engagement keeps being measured at that level. And when parents don't show up, then it's because they don't care. Then it's because they don't care about their kids' education. I can't tell you how many times I've heard that. There's a lack of representation in the curriculum. There's a lack of representation in Latino teachers. And that's the issue of segregated schools continues to be a problem. There's unequal funding, and there's student tracking. Oh my God, student tracking. And coming out of a community college, don't hold this against me, but I see a lot of efforts to say to the African American and Latino communities, go to the trades area. Don't go to college, you can make more money, you know, become a plumber. Becoming an electrician, which is probably true, but there's more to it than that. A four-year university degree is not necessarily designed for you to make more money than an electrician. It opens your mind. It allows you to think critically. It allows you to question your reality. It gives you way more than just money. It allows you to become an engaged and informed citizen of this country. And we are losing that as higher education. We are beginning to think that education is something that we are doing because we want to make a profit out of it. It's seen as a profit maker. It's seen as something that's going to give you more money instead of actually opening your eyes and your mind. One of the questions that I ask when people say, well, Jesus, it's, you know, college is not for everyone. And I keep asking them, is that the same message that you're giving kids over in Kenilworth? No, of course not, because it's a given for them that they will attend a four-year university at least, if not continue on to graduate school. Why is it that for our kids, the expectation is less? And of course, economic pressures. When I have a family of four, where mom and dad has two jobs, and the kid is in high school and decides, you know what, I gotta help my mom, she's aging terribly because she has no sleep at nights, I gotta get a job and bring something to the table, that's a pressure on our kids to actually go out and work. And that's why a living wage is so important for our families. These are some statistics just out of Waukegan, and this is not updated, but they remain the same, pretty much the same. This is a year ago. We look at Waukegan with a 79% Latino student body in the high school, or actually the district. 79% of the kids in Waukegan school district are Latino. And yet, I can't read that from there, 75% of their teachers are non-Latinos, are white. There's a discrepancy there. 4.9% of 8th graders passed Algebra 1 in the district. 4.9%. 72% of the students graduating of the high school need post-secondary remediation. Only 24% are college ready. And only 47% enroll in higher education after 12 months graduation. The inequality in our school districts is appalling. How many of you remember this crisis in Baltimore? There were attending classes in a school with no heat. I just wonder, would other communities take this? No, never. And yet, our own communities tolerate it. The ban of Mexican American studies in Arizona was a big issue a couple years ago. So they had a bunch of Latinos failing out of class, not finishing high school, and they had big issues. They had a graduation rate in the 40s back in Arizona. They implemented this program, and their graduation rates went up to 85%, I believe, almost 90%. And yet the school district banned the program. And that's the same thing that's happening with bilingual programs across the state of Illinois. You know, even though they show progress, we're getting rid of them. Same thing happened in Arizona. Well, thankfully, after many years of litigation, they reinstalled it. But when you think about why would a program like Mexican American Studies create such an incremental increase or a great increase in the graduation rates, what is it that allowed Latinos to actually move on and graduate after taking a course like this? Any ideas? Yes?
Yes. They were inspired for more.
Absolutely. Yes, that's one of many things, role models. But it also instills a sense of pride, something that is lacking in the curriculum, something that is lacking in our understanding of who we are as Latinos. Being able to be proud and say, you know what, I am coming from this wonderful lineage of great people. Even though all I see is the contributions of other Americans in my textbooks, I know that I have the capacity to do great things. Some of the current events that we're looking at, the census, the disempowerment of our community because of the ICE raids, because of the immigration piece, people being fearful of being counted. Every Latino that is fearful of being counted, that is not gonna fill out the census sheets, is money that is gonna cost our county and our city and our state. there's a, there was an ongoing battle about the citizenship question on the census. That's an attempt, again, to disempower our communities and make our communities suffer for no actual purpose. Gentrification of our areas, when you look at Chicago, you look at Pilsen, used to be a Mexican clique there, and had a long tradition of welcoming immigrants into that area. Now it's they're being pushed out. They're being pushed out because of the rising rents and because of the desire of other communities to utilize that space differently. The idea of divide and conquer, DACA was a perfect example. We had two sides in our community as Latinos. We had those Latinos that said, yes, give my kids the ability to go to school, the ability to get a driver's license, the ability to lose their fear of contributing to this country. And you had another side of Latinos that said, no way, I've been waiting in line for 20 years. Why are you giving these kids this opportunity? You know, and so it was used against us. The idea that we were so divided on the issue was tough. The relationship with our African American brothers and sisters, the fact again that we've been pegged against each other for decades is another sore thorn in our side. And nowadays, not as much now because of the media, they've lost a little bit of coverage there with Las Caravanas, the caravans of immigrants coming to the U.S. And there's a lack of understanding as to why is it that, you know, some of us are adamant that we have a responsibility with these people. When you look back at the responsibility of this country to the coup d'etats, to the overthrowing of governments, to the initiation of civil wars in Central America, to the illegal trade of arms into those countries, there is a responsibility that we have as Americans. Most of it, and I say this quite, you know, sure of it, most of the issues that we have seen in those governments, in those societies, we created, our government created. There was, in the 1950s, a president in Guatemala, this is just an example of many, who came into power in the 1954, and he took on one of the biggest landowners in Guatemala, the United Fruit Company. They owned vast amounts of land that were sitting there, not producing anything. And the president comes in and began land reform, saying, you know what, I gotta give some of this land back to the peasants. Those that are being hungry, those that can work the land and get something out of it, those that needed to survive. And what did our government do? Exactly. They said, this is communism. We need to get rid of it. They overthrow the government and they get a civil war. And that is the same recipe that we've done in El Salvador, that we've done in Honduras, that we've done in Nicaragua, that we are trying to do in Venezuela. It's the same recipe, and we apparently don't learn. So the U.S. role in the violence, again, with gangs and guns. People say that, or a lot of people say that, you know, we are deporting gang members, criminals, hardened criminals. And there is a number of them, absolutely. We can't deny that. But there are also reasons why they become criminals in our society. When those young immigrants from El Salvador came to Los Angeles, for example, and they were faced with racism, not only from white Americans, but from Mexicans living in Los Angeles, they needed to find a way of protecting each other, a way of finding family, a way of feeling safe. And what did they do? They created gangs for protection. So it's our fault that they weren't welcome. It's our fault that they fell into the hands of these gangs. We created the problem. Let's send them back now as hardened criminals. And then we ask ourselves, why is it that these countries are facing such a challenge with violence? Because we created it. Not only did we create it, we are sending guns to those countries. They have they don't have a single gun factory in El Salvador or Honduras. Where do they get their weapons? They get it from us. And is it so hard for us to stop the flow of weapons there? Don't answer me, because we know the answer. So I talked a little bit about the United Fruit Company, and again, the immigration piece, we're responsible for it. We need the workers. we just don't want them to integrate them into, we don't want them to integrate into our society. And what we are pursuing as a country and our government is pursuing is an agreement where they can actually bring the workers in and send them back. This is the Bracero program all over again. And here we are going to be charging them for Social Security and Medicare and all of those things, which is great because it's going to come, you know, it's going to be money that's going to come in for my retirement. But heck, are they going to get anything out of it? Probably not. We are looking for a disposable workforce. And that idea needs to change. When we look at temp agencies out in Waukegan and North Chicago, that's the same idea. Companies getting our people in and seeing them as disposable resources. So what about me? Why are you giving on and on and on and on here? This was just tell me what should I do, what can I do? A couple things. Be critical. Being critical doesn't mean being a naysayer, doesn't mean being mean. It means questioning the reasons behind decisions taken. Because whenever a decision is made that affects your people and your community, you have to ask what is the idea behind it. Why are we taking that decision and how is it going to affect the most vulnerable populations within our community? Think freely. Get your news from many resources. Diversify your news sources. Understand the lenses that people are using and why is it that they are pushing forth that idea. When we look at Fox News, it's very different than MSN News. Very different. What lens are they using and what is the agenda behind what they're producing? Educate yourself, most importantly. I have a couple examples of the books that have changed my life as a Latino up here. So if you're interested in looking at these titles, feel free to come up. This is my Bible. This is my Bible. It's called Latinos in Education, a Critical Reader. And it's edited by Antonia Darder and Rodolfo Torres. This thing is a wealth of information. It has articles, excerpts from books that talk about the Latino reality, but also about some of the things that have made progress that, you know, we are actually working on and we're being successful at doing. I'll leave it up here if anybody wants to take a look. It has highlights also. I've used it many times. So if you just go through it and look at the highlights, I'm sure you'll get the message. Learn your history. History, again, is so important because if you don't know where you're coming from, you have no idea what your place is and where you're going. History is so important. Be proud of your culture, regardless of what it is. Make sure you have the knowledge and the ability to say, this is where I'm coming from, and geez, were we smart. We have the capacity to do this. Keep or learn your language. And this goes to Latinos in particular. I don't know that I would be here without Spanish because it allows you to connect back to your community. When you lose the language, you lose your connection to your abuelitas. You lose your connection to the people that have the experience, that have done the sacrifice to have you be in America. You cannot lose that connection. With that, I'll take questions. So the first one is Latinos in Education, a Critical Reader. It's the second edition, but there's a newer one, I believe, and it's not cheap. So if anybody needs to borrow it, I'm happy to let you borrow it. And it's edited by Antonia Darder and Rodolfo Torres.
It's like 45 on the Amazon
right now. It's a great book, really, really great book. The other one is Working From Within, by Luis Urrieta. And this one, and this is specifically good for our students. Even though the title says Chicano and Chicana Activists in White Stream Schools, this is incredibly relevant to our students because you're gonna start reading this and you're going to understand a lot of things that you didn't understand when you were in school. This guy was talking about me. And when I talked to my other cohort members, like, no, he was talking about me.
You know, so it's really the experience of all of us. It's the experience of all of us. We share it, and I think it's a great thing. The other one is Borderlands, La Frontera. Borderlands by Borderlands, the new Mestiza, and this one is by Gloria Anzaldúa. And Gloria Anzaldúa is an incredible writer who actually talks about community and the community wealth model. The idea that there is knowledge within our community, that even though it's not academic knowledge, it's knowledge that allows us to survive. And so it's an incredible book. It's not expensive, it's like 10 bucks or something. But what makes her, I'm sorry?
Repeat the title, please.
Borderlands, The New Mestiza, by Gloria Anzaldúa. And Gloria, again, she is Latina, but she's also a lesbian Latina. And so she has this wonderful way of interpreting her experiences and bringing them back to culture. And she actually bashes Latino culture in many, many points in this book because we're not perfect, of course. And one of the things that she keeps saying is, you know, even though we keep talking about how important family is as a lesbian, my family turned their backs on me. And so we cannot be as hypocritical as that when we are talking about how important family is. And so this is, again, a great book, and I highly recommend those three titles. However, when you are looking at scholarship, don't just rely on books. We have a wonderful library, and I'm sure we have access to articles like this one. The Legacy of Derrick Bell in Latino Education, and it's written by Luis Urrieta, the same guy that wrote the other book. But The Legacy of Derrick Bell, and if you don't know the name Derrick Bell, you need to learn it, because that's the father of critical race theory and the way that he describes it. Derrick Bell, African American, who truly developed the idea of critical race and began to question some of the systems that we have. He's an incredible writer. I truly enjoy his books. He has a book called Faces at the Bottom of the Well. It's a very short book, but it's incredibly powerful. So that would be one of my recommendations as well. Other questions? Esa cara de asustados. Yes?
I'm really curious about that one page that you put together from 15-something.
I didn't put it together. Actually, that was the University of Washington.
Okay.
I'm happy to share it, absolutely.
Yeah, what document was that from?
That was from, I took it out of a dissertation from the University of Washington.
I think, you know, talking about cultural pride, I think that's a fantastic piece to look back on.
It's actually I have the website actually back down there. And once I make public the presentation, you'll be able to get it for that. Yes.
Muchas gracias, me da mucho orgullo, thank you very much, it gives me a lot of pride. And that's something that I've seen as a sophomore, DACA recipient here at the College of Lake County. I just got back from doing a table talk with Warren Township High School, and all the people that were my friends from a lot of South Future Latino leaders came up, hugged me, and they were like, oh my God, Mace, thank you so much for doing this. And
what did you do?
And what I would just do is give them pens and said, look, you can do this. Go to a COC and write your own history, write your own future. And what you just told me, the pride, the history, we need to do that. The reason why I know about the Chicano movement is due to the Chicano College Board. Would you be, okay with having some students host that? COC hosting the Chicago College Board to show students. This is a high school based thing.
Out of Highland Park.
Yes, and that's the thing. Why don't we bring them to COC, the next step, that learning doesn't just stop at high school, but we can actually go.
I can't talk for the Grace Lake campus, but I can tell you that I would host it at the Grace Lake campus. And I'm sure that the Grace Lake campus would be open to doing that as well.
I can add to that answer. Harvard College has a Latinx Student Summit. It's actually this Friday, right? And so we're going to kind of go check it out, maybe have a partnership, maybe bring it to CLC or maybe develop our own here. So Lisa, I think that would be maybe the first step and then maybe that you should have. That conversation is next.
Good. Thanks. Thank you, Jason. Mm-hmm. Anything else before we go? Yes.
What are things that we as students right now?
So one of the things that I think is so important for students, and in particular students of color, to do is to understand that by being here, we have privilege. That we have a privilege that not everybody in our communities have. How do we use our privilege to make sure that we are opening doors to the next generation? How do we use our privilege to make systemic changes in the way that higher education works towards our people? I was in a meeting this morning with Dr. Sudik, and one of the things that she said is, you know, we are basically trying to break the mold. We are trying to disturb the system. And that's part of the idea, that as more members of our communities are able to understand what the barriers are, we're able to tear them down. But you as a student, first of all, you need to be successful academically, because if you're not successful academically, then we are losing you, right? So we need you to concentrate on being successful, being able to reach your goals, but also never forget where you're coming from. An example, I've been in Waukegan for 28 years. Most of my peers who have been successful out of Waukegan, whose education was paid with Waukegan taxpayer dollars, have left the community. We have a huge brain drain in Waukegan. We educate successful people, they leave us, and they never come back. That's part of the problem. If all the successful people that we have spent our hard-earned dollars in educating in Waukegan would come back, our community would be very different. And that's part of the challenge. How do you as a student, once you are successful educationally and have a good paying job, will give back to those that you left behind?
Yes. How do we deal with Latinos that are against or on the other side? As you might have heard, Latinos for Trump, there's a big population of Latinos that are Republican. How do we go about reaching to them and not fighting one another?
There's a great book out there called Pedagogy of the Oppressed, Paulo Freire. And Paulo Freire talks about oppression and the fact that those who are oppressed want to become the oppressor, because that's what you see as the highest pinnacle of society. And so, as oppressed people, you want to reach that high. You want to become the oppressor. And so you find ways of demonstrating your ability, of demonstrating you are worth being part of that top level group. And the only way you can find that is by becoming the oppressor. And that's one of the ways that we see happen, you know, one of the things that we see happening. One of the things that they don't realize is that by becoming the oppressor, they're turning their backs on the people that most need them. And they're brilliant people. But sometimes our priorities are not aligned as a community. And I think for those Latinos that see it that way, is a lack of information. And it's a lack of pride, and it's a lack of understanding of who they are and who their ancestors were. But I think a big role that culture plays in there is the fact that they want to be accepted into mainstream society. And so if you as a Latino like myself start questioning mainstream society, then you're not necessarily accepted as easily as if you play the game. And that's what they're doing. So what do we do about it? Trying to inform them, trying to educate them.
They need to see things.
Yes?
I always thought about it, because I also keep from walking in as well, and I always thought of, like, how can we give back to our community? Like, starting in ethnic studies or in Avanza in Waukegan, because we clearly know that, I remember the one from Arizona, that study was done by Stanford and how they showed that ethnic studies help students. So what can anybody who is a resident of Waukegan or has their children there right now, or students that are in Waukegan, could they go to the school board and demand or ask?
You've hit the nail on the head. There's a problem with demanding action in our Latino districts. Not because people don't care, but because people don't know that they have the power to do that. People need to wake up, and it's upon all of us who are privileged enough to understand the system to educate them. When you look at systems in Mexico, for example, in other Latin American countries, regular people don't have that ability to actually run a school board, make decisions as a school board, or elect a school board. All of the decisions are made at the federal government level. But here, there's a different system in place where community actually has a say. And our people don't understand that. Our people don't get that connection yet. And so the challenge is being able to educate our parents, being able to educate our community members about the power they actually have and haven't exploded. And I'll say, you know, in regards to the creation of programs like that, I truly believe that the Lakeshore campus is a place where we have a lot of work to do and develop. And being at the heart of a minority community, you know, I would love to see an ethnic studies group over there. I would love to see a Latino club, a Latino union club, more vibrant student life. And we are making the right steps towards that. But it doesn't happen overnight. And you know, the new dean, I need a little bit of time, but we'll get there. Anything else?
Do you have any more questions before I wrap it up?
Thank you for being here. Thank you so much for being here. This has been probably one of the biggest audience that I've seen this presentation. And I have to say that I'm very proud of the CLC community, because I didn't know what to expect. And so I really appreciate you being here, having an open mind, and it's been wonderful. Thank you.